Bismillah. I have the honor and privilege of introducing our commencement speaker, who has come all the way from the great city of Istanbul, what was formerly known as Constantinople. It's one of the great centers of civilization. And Dr. Recep Şentürk, who I had the good fortune of meeting several years ago, is, I think, really one of the truly great visionaries in the Muslim community today. He's an indefatigable worker for the cause of harmony amongst civilizations. He's the head of a beautiful institution of higher education in Istanbul. Many of the things that they're doing there dovetail with what we're trying to do here. And it's a great honor and privilege that he's come this far to address us and taken his time, because I know he's one of the most busy people that I know. He has the unique vantage point of somebody who has mastered two civilizations. It's enough to master one civilization, like al-Mutanabbi said, "Ma ra'aytu naqsan min 'uyub an-nasi ka naqsi al-qadirin 'ala at-tamami." I've never seen a blemish worse than somebody's failure to complete the perfection of something. So to know two civilizations is quite an accomplishment. He is trained in the traditional Ottoman classical educational system, which was a liberal arts tradition that culminated in theology and law and medicine. But he's also a PhD from Columbia University in sociology and very well steeped in the humanities and social sciences of the West. So it's my sincere and grateful honor of introducing Dr. Recep Şentürk.
Esselamu aleykum ve rahmetullahi ve berekatuhu. Euzubillahimineşşeytanirracim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسولنا وحبيبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب قلوبنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وإخوانه من الأنبياء والمرسلين أجمعين. I brought you salams of your brothers and sisters in Istanbul from sister institutions, and we are working for the same cause. I have had the honor to deliver many lectures around the world in prestigious academic institutions, but none of them have made me as happy and honored than this lecture here at Zeytuna College, because Zeytuna is very dear to my heart, and I see it as our hope for rebuilding Islam as an open civilization in America and the world, under the leadership of my dear colleague, brother and friend, Hamza Yusuf and Zeyd Shakir. Zeytuna College is an enlightening tree, of a knowledge whose light comes neither from east nor from west, but directly from the divine light bestowed by Allah upon humanity through his beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and transmitted to us by an unbroken chain of scholars and saints for 15 centuries until today, without any corruption. Zeytuna graduates constitute the last link of this golden chain of scholars and saints, and they will transmit the sacred trust they inherited from their teachers to their students, with the purpose of extending this chain of transmission to many centuries to come without compromising its reliability and authenticity. I stand here to convey you the message that Islam is an open civilization built upon two fundamental principles: multiplexity and universal humanism. In Arabic, maratib and adamiyye. But Muslims forgot these two principles under the influence of modernism and postmodernism, and deviated from the open civilization tradition in Islam. I stand here to call you to correct this error and work towards reviving Islam as an open civilization by reviving its two fundamental principles, multiplicity and ademiyya. Today, Islam is a fast-growing religion, if not the fastest growing religion in the world. It is now the second religion in Europe and in America. Just recently, a Muslim has become the mayor of London. Prior to this, the mayor of Amsterdam was also a Muslim. It's commonly known that Muslims are now in the US Senate and House of Representatives in America. Islam is spreading fast in Africa, Japan, Russia, as well as in other parts of the world. This makes people wonder what will be the result and the implications. Non-Muslims rightfully ask, what would Muslims do if they gain power? What would humanity gain or lose with the spread of Islam? Those who criticize Islam try to convince the world at large that Muslims will terrorize the whole world. We as Muslims should ask the same question to ourselves. What's our future vision for Islamic civilization and the whole world? What's our promise to humanity? The Muslim youth is waiting answers for these questions. By asking these questions, I reflect the quest of the world public opinion and the Muslim youth. But also, I change the conventional questions Muslims have been asking for the last two centuries. What has the world lost with the fall of Islam? This is the title of a famous book by Ebul Hasan al-Nedvi. I change this question and ask, what would the world gain with the spread of Islam and the rise of Islamic civilization? Likewise, Muslims have been asking for the last two centuries, what should we take from the West? The question I propose is rather different. What can we give to the West and to the humanity? My answer to these questions is very simple: open civilization. Our future vision of Islam is an open civilization. As Muslims, our promise to humanity is to be an open civilization. Humanity will gain open civilization with the flourishing Islam. But what's open civilization and why should we call Islam an open civilization? I divide civilizations into two categories: open civilizations and closed civilizations. By open civilization, I mean a civilization which acknowledges the existence of other civilizations and tries to build peaceful relations with them and find ways to coexist with them. In contrast, a closed civilization sees itself as the only civilization in the world and tries to eliminate other civilizations. From this perspective, Islam is an open civilization. This is how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam built Islam from the very beginning in Medina. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught to his companions that Islam is the true religion, but not the only religion in the world. This is evident in the constitution of Medina, which brought together Muslims and non-Muslims as citizens of a state, and he built a consensus among these citizens. And Prophet Muhammad granted human rights to non-Muslims who denied that he was the messenger of Allah. They denied that Quran is the book of Allah, but he still granted them freedom of religion. Yet at that time, during Middle Ages, most of the other civilizations in the world were closed civilizations, from China to India, from Iran to Europe. Then the pressing question is, why was Islam an open civilization during the Middle Ages when all other civilizations were closed civilizations? What made Prophet Muhammad give freedom to people who thought that he was not a true messenger of God? And what made Islam give freedom to people who denied Islam as a religion of Allah? Our fuqaha, our ulama, answers this question as follows. They say that the purpose of Islamic polity, Islamic law, is to help realize Allah's purpose in creating humanity. So what's the purpose of Allah in creating humanity? It is to test them, to try them. And a true test can take place only if everyone is free when they take this test. They must have the freedom to err or to answer in a correct way. So the purpose of Islamic political system, legal system, is not to impose Islam on other people, but to create the environment, free environment of test. And this is needed so that the existence of paradise and hellfire also makes sense. Because paradise is a reward for people who choose to do the right thing, although they had the possibility and freedom of doing the wrong thing. And hellfire is a punishment for people who did the wrong thing, although they had the possibility and freedom of doing the right thing. So the purpose of Islamic political system, legal system, is to achieve God's purpose in creating humanity, which is a true and genuine test. As I mentioned about Islam, as an open civilization, has been built upon two pillars, multiplexity and Adamiyya. Let me explain what's meant by these two principles. Multiplexity is the philosophical and conceptual foundation of open civilization, and Adamiyya, which is the universal humanism, is the foundation of Islamic legal system. Multiplexity reflects itself in several areas. First, in our approach to existence. We accept that there is material world and there is non-material world and also divine world. These are different levels of existence, which I call multiplex ontology. Traditionally, it was called Maratib al-Wujud. Similar to this, there is a multiplex epistemology, which was called Maratib al-Ulum. Every level of existence requires a special epistemology for this particular level of existence. That's why, Islamically, we accept that there are multiple levels of knowledge which utilizes reason, sense perception, revelation, and ma'rifah or irfan, experiential knowledge derived through kashf. And corresponding to these levels of existence and levels of knowledge, there are multiple levels of methodology, which I call multiplex methodology. Traditionally, it was called Maratib al-Usul. It incorporates rational methods, empirical methods, and interpretive methods, as well as spiritual methods. Similar to this, our interpretive system accepts multiplex hermeneutics, which was called Maratib al-Ma'ani. A text has external meaning, internal meaning, and also meaning of meaning. So this is a very interesting term. Muslims invented meaning of meaning. Let me explain it to you with an example. So if somebody knocks the door and the person inside says there is no one inside, what's the meaning of this? So the meaning of it is that I don't want you to come in. But you cannot get this meaning simply by looking at the sentence itself. So this is the meaning of meaning. And again, similar to this, there is a multiplex normative system, which is expressed in Maratib al-Ahkam. According to Fuqaha in general, there is five norms which may be attached to an action, and according to the Hanafi school, nine norms, 9 values, normative values, may be attached to the action of a human being. So our normative system did not work using a binary logic, which is based on right and wrong. We have fard and haram, and in between, makruh tahriman, makruh tanzihan, mustahab, mandub, sunnah muakkada, sunnah ghayr muakkada, and wajib. So it employs a multi-valued logic rather than a binary logic, which is used presently in modern law and morality. And this leads us to maratib al-haqaiq, multiplex truth, that truth has multiple levels. And there is at one level absolute truth, at another level relative truth. And in order for people to understand this, they go through an education which has degrees. And their heart goes through transformations. Modern psychology takes human psychology as something static. But according to Islamic psychology, in tasawwuf, human psychology, the heart goes through transformations from nafs ammara to nafs lawwama to nafs mulhima to nafs mutmainna. So in Arabic, they translate psychology as ilm al-nafs. And when I meet my colleagues, Arab colleagues, and when they say, I study ilm al-nafs, I ask them, which nafs you study? A multiplex system of thought uses multi-valued logic rather than binary logic. It is the conceptual foundation of open civilization because it forestalls reductionism and relativism. Materialism and idealism are two forms of Western reductionism. Yet in multiplex worldview, material and ideal reality constitute two different levels of existence. Modernism emphasized unity and single universal truth, while postmodernism emphasized diversity and relativism. However, multiplexity allows accommodating different views at different levels without falling into reductionism and relativism. Therefore, it's a better strategy for diversity management than postmodernity. When we look at the Islamic intellectual history, I see three periods. The classical period, which was completely characterized by multiplex thought. Then in the 20th century, there was a very tense clash between unilayered worldview based on materialism, reductionist, using a positivist understanding of existence, knowledge, and methodology with the multiplex traditional Islamic worldview. And we Muslims, because of our love for modernism and modernization, abundant, such a sophisticated worldview, and abundant and adopted reductionist, positivist worldview. And now we are in the 21st century. I think that it's a time for us to critically examine what we did, whether it was right or wrong. And I believe that we did wrong choices. Our civilization went into wrong direction and it deviated from this multiplex thinking to unilayered thought. And the second foundation of open civilization is Adamiyya. It comes from the term, the word Adam. Adamiyya means Adamness or Adamhood, which I translate as universal humanism because it's a concept used in Islamic law. This term is the legal and moral foundation of open civilization. In contrast, secularist and religious nationalism and racism are the legal and moral foundations of closed civilizations. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Adamiyya, universal humanism, the foundation of Islamic legal, moral, political, and ethical system. Later, Fuqaha formulated it as a legal maxim, and it is stated that al-isma bil-adamiyya, which means inviolability, is due for humanity. This legal maxim grants inviolability of human rights to every human being, regardless of his or her nationality, religion, gender, race, color, and wealth, simply because he or she is a human being. And these rights are enforced by the legal system. It covers inviolability of life, property, religion, mind, honor, and family. When it says inviolability of religion, it is not only Islam, but all religion. When it says life, it is not the lives of Muslims, but the lives of all Adamis, all human beings. So, and the terms used in our tradition for universal human rights include the following. Hukuk al-Adamiyin, rights of the Adamis. Hurmat al-Adamiyin, inviolability of human beings. Kulliyat, which means universal rights. And daruriyat, which means necessary, indispensable, inalienable rights. These are the terms used in our classical law books. And this idea was not a utopia. It was implemented first by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself in Medina, later by the Umayyads, Abbasids, Ottomans in Andalusia, and in India under the Baburs or Mughals. Among all these examples, the most interesting one to show the universality of Islamic law and the universalism of Islamic law is the Islamic rule in India. Because in India, Muslims ruled Hindus and Buddhists, and they granted them the same rights they granted to Christians and Jews in other parts of the world. Today, it is commonly known that Muslims accept Abrahamic religions, but it is less known that Muslims grant the same rights granted to Christians and Jews under Islamic rule to non-Ahli Kitab. And today, non-Ahli Kitab people constitute 45% of the world population. And we have to explain to them that because they are Adamis, we respect them. This is part of our law. But when we look at the Islamic history, we see that in the classical period, this principle was implemented. And Ottomans institutionalized it as millet system. There is Jewish millet, Orthodox millet, Armenian millet, later Protestants and Catholics were also given the status of millet. They were free in their internal affairs. And in 19th century, second half of the 19th century, some reforms took place under the late Ottoman caliphs. They abolished slavery in 1847. They abolished dhimmi status and the jizya tax in 1856. They adopted constitutional system in 1876. And they also adopted parliamentary system. And they had several multi-party elections. And all these things took place by the advice of ulama, the Ottoman ulama and the Sheikh al-Islam under the Khalifa. But when nation-state models were adopted by Muslims after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, Muslims abandoned the concept of Adamiyya and universal humanism of Islam. They adopted nationalist ideologies and they justified it either through secularist or Islamic terms. The 20th century is the century of westernization and modernization in the Muslim world. As a result, Muslims adopted closed civilization model based on nationalism all over the Muslim world. In reaction, another ideological position emerged, which advocated protection of the rights of Muslims alone. This was a deviation from the universalist tradition of Islam. Both positions, whether secular nationalism or Islamic nationalism, represent a clear deviation from the open civilization tradition in Islam. And finally, where do we go from here? Now I see the signs of the fourth period, a new period, which is characterized with a call to open civilization. It's high time to call to end the deviation from the Islamic open civilization. How can we revive Islam as an open civilization once again? We need to do two things. First, revive multiplex worldview, maratib. Second, revive the concept of Ademiyye as the foundation of Islamic social thought. Today, Muslims forgot the multiplexity and Ademiyye doctrine. We disowned our heritage, the Ademiyye paradigm, and the multiplex worldview. We need to reclaim this legacy as an alternative to what modernists and postmodernists offer to us. We need to re-establish two principles of Islamic thought in our education. First, that the existence, knowledge, method, meaning, norms, and truth are multiplex. Second, every human being is inviolable for the sake of his or her humanity. These are the two foundations of our open civilization. It is based on unity in multiplexity. I'm not saying unity in diversity. I am saying unity in multiplexity because there is a maratib. If you want to revive Islamic civilization, we need to revive the Islamic worldview and knowledge. This cannot be achieved without reviving Islamic education. Open civilization today is no longer a choice. It's a necessity, and we need to reconfigure everything we do and all our institutions accordingly. This is needed to adjust ourselves to the present and to prepare ourselves for the future. I see that Zeytuna College is playing a major role in educating Muslims and non-Muslims in leading their way towards reviving open civilization in America. Reviving Islam as an open civilization is a dream. You may also call it a utopia. Karl Mannheim, however, the famous sociologist, in his book titled Utopia, says that the social change comes only from utopia. You need a utopia to create social change. We need a dream to bring about social change along with Islamic lines. This dream must derive from the Quran, from the Sunnah, and from the dream of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It should be a revival of Prophet Muhammad alaihi wasallam's dream about his ummah and humanity. It is his dream which created a great change, a great change in human history. We need it again to create another change, to save our planet and the world from the problems caused by closed civilizations and the misinterpretation of Islam as a closed civilization. We need this vision, this dream, or the utopia for two reasons. First, to offer it to our youth and the ummah as a future goal around which we can unite and mobilize the whole ummah. Otherwise, false visions will fill the vacuum and mislead our youth, as you are regrettably witnessing today. Second, to tell humanity, outside observers, and the bystanders what we aim for the future, what contribution we plan to make to the world, what we promise to humanity, be they Muslims and non-Muslims, be they Ahli Kitab or non-Ahli Kitab. In conclusion, I would like to repeat that it's my dream to revive Islam as an open civilization, and this is the dream we inherited from Prophet Muhammad alayhi wasalam, based on multiplex view and Ademiyye concept, and I am here to call you to share this dream with me. Zeytuna graduates should leave Zeytuna, not only with this, with the knowledge of Islam, but also with a dream for the future of Islam. I am here to offer you this dream. Yet, you should always keep in mind that the only way to realize your dream is to wake up and work. Before I end, I would like to advise to the graduates of Zeytune to continue combining their traditional and modern studies until they truly become a true scholar, an alim, to lead their communities, the ummah, and the humanity in the right path. I leave you with three key words to keep in mind. You can forget everything, just remember these three words: open civilization, multiplexity, and Adamiyya. Thank you, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.